Hawkins left Bradley as the Missouri Valley Conference's all-time leading scorer. He graduated on time, was a member of the 88 Olympic basketball team that competed in Seoul, and was a first-round NBA pick. Later an all-star, the Hawk has quietly become a steady NBA performer. And, as is his nature, continues to give back in hosting a weekend of winners' all-star game between Bradley and Illinois State alums at Children's Hospital of Illinois. Telling the tale for seven seniors, there were notable highlights. Anthony Manuel was named Missouri Valley Conference Player of the Year as a point guard, leading the league in scoring and becoming the school's all-time leader in assists. Peoria Manuel's Curtis Stuckey transferred from Drake and again led the Missouri Valley Conference in scoring. There were special wins at West Virginia and the Braves' only win in Redbird Arena. But talent slowly waned. Those players with talent, for various reasons, failed to reach expectations and fell by the wayside. The losses mounted, and the likable Stan Albeck, who kept seven seniors from leaving in 86, wasn't able to sustain the level of excellence when they left. 2 days after his team was eliminated from the Missouri Valley Conference tournament in St. Louis, the school announced Stan's resignation.
I'm personally sorry to see Stan leave, but with the attendance at the games and the declining results in the Chiefs Club fundraising efforts, it's probably time for a change in leadership.
That season, a team emerged in the Mid-Continent Conference, the Huskies of Northern Illinois. They had made the NCAA tournament. And their coach, a graduate of Illinois Wesleyan, and an assistant in the glory days of DePaul with Ray Meyer, became the leading candidate for the Bradley job. Then on April 12th, 1991.
I think we have found the man who meets all of these qualities. I'm excited for Bradley. I'm excited for Peoria. I'm excited for our basketball program and our basketball players. Please let me introduce our new head basketball coach, Mr. Jim Molinari.
I don't consider myself a miracle worker. I don't consider myself a person that can guarantee anything except this, that our young men will represent Bradley and you with that type of attitude that we just talked about, and with integrity. And that you'll see young men who will understand that their first goal here is to get a degree. And also, that these young men will also understand that we're trying to build that attitude in them, and you'll see great effort on the court as far as just the way we play. Those are the things I think a coach can guarantee. Whatever else might happen, I think that's something that we'll just have to see based on our schedule and our talent level.
Molinari's coaching career at Bradley began with three consecutive wins at St. Louis, at home against Chicago State, a thrilling Carver Arena overtime victory over Tennessee Chattanooga. But then reality set in, and a coach used to winning saw just how far his goal was from attaining. But he kept his promise, graduate his players, and created solid citizens as well as players that Bradley fans could be proud of. Sean Smith, James Bailey, Dwayne Broussard. Peoria High School's Charles White. Marcus Pollard. And David Chainsaw Winslow. So he would build and began building relationships.
Coach Mo came in and he saw me play AU summer game. Played the worst game of my life, shot like two air balls, you know, just played horrible because I was so nervous that he was there. And he drove home, it was like an hour drive, and he sat down and said he still wanted me. And I was like, wow, you know, I played the worst game of my life. This guy still liked me. And I guess he saw things that I wasn't really aware that I was doing. And so, I mean, he just decided to come here.
And I didn't know too much about, you know, what really went on here, Bradley or in Peoria. But I think just the overall genuine interest that the coaches had in me kind of sold me on coming to Bradley.
The frustration mounted, and so did the losses. But there would come a day setbacks would pay dividends.
You know, maybe right now we're not good enough to win. But if we keep building the right things in our program, someday we will. Someday we will.
I would have to say the DePaul game my freshman year, and we beat DePaul, and I think someone said that that was the first time Bradley had beaten DePaul since, was it 56, 52? It was way back sometime. And when we won that game, and against a very good DePaul team at that, and what was going through my mind was, you know, we had the place rocking, and I'm looking around, I'm seeing guys who are gonna be here three more years with me, and I saw how well they were playing, and I knew that if I really worked it, I could get better to play also. I came to that point, I was like, before I graduate, I gotta get a championship here. And I really thought that it could happen.
Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer.
Step up and knock one down. With it is Jackson. Drives around his man baseline. Flipped it up and in.
Come on, shake your body, baby. Do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Feel the rhythm of the music getting stronger. Don't you fight it till you try to do that conga beat.
Now back to Bill. Pull up 19-footer. Yes! It's a three-point lead. Billy in the backcourt. Goes around one, around two. The bounce passes to Klein. Now to Parker. Three-on-one break. No look pass.
He got a steal and a layup to win the game.
Anything right now.
They break Reed Jackson to the ball. He has it. Falls down. Jackson steals. Gives to Parker. He's going to drive. Kick it off Burrell for the win. Yes!
We'll be right back.
Joke around a lot, but we may write a book about this. You know, if someone seriously sat down, probably could write a book of how, you know, it just turned around. And that's a credit to Coach Mo and his staff, because they knew coming in they was going to have to rebuild. And I knew coming in that it was going to be 1 or 2 years rebuilding. And we did a pretty good job as coming in as freshmen and making the adjustment. And here we are today.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Tale of the Long Road Back. I'm your host, Dave Snell. It's been 8 years since Bradley University's basketball team played in the NCAA tournament, and so many things have happened. This show tonight is dedicated to six seniors that will not receive championship rings, but were building blocks and cornerstones towards this championship year. We also dedicate it to the memory of Dick Lean and Mort Cantor, who followed Bradley basketball for so many years. This season, a championship season, the last crack for five seniors, four of which helped build the basketball program. So sit back and enjoy now as we tell the story of 1995-96 Bradley basketball in the Tale of the Long Road Back.
Billy Wright with it. Running off a screen, Parker. His three ball is up and good. Bradley lead. Thompson takes it all the way in. Deal a steal. Ball's loose on the floor. Funch has it. On the move. Come on.
The tale of the long road back actually begins in Anderson, Indiana, where a former Bradley Brave had a preseason basketball prophecy.
Yeah, they'll definitely win the league this year, and I think Deanna will be the MVP. Him or Anthony, Coach Monero, will be the coach of the year. So I hope those guys keep fighting hard, keep praying for me, be you number one all the way.
The season began against four teams that would play in the postseason, two of them on the road. The opener against the Big Eight's Kansas State was a difficult lesson learned. The Braves blew a huge lead. And in the second half, up three, were tied at the buzzer and lost their only overtime game of the season, 75-72. Next was a night to remember in Philadelphia against the third-ranked Villanova Wildcats. Ahead in the second half, Bradley played shorthanded. Aaron Zober suffered a severe ankle sprain. Ben Coupette was ejected for retaliating to punches thrown by two Villanova players. The Braves lost 70-63 and played this game without Deion Jackson.
It just hit me, you know, after I seen my teeth on the floor right there, to, you know, I probably wouldn't be in this game. And, you know, I think not only me, but the rest of the team and the coaching staff was, you know, really prepared to play against this team that night. We had worked all week, and we were just ready to make that next step in this program. And to know that I wasn't going to be a part of it, you know, right off the start, you know, in the first minute of the game, I think that really hurt me. But I think with me not being there, I think our team still got nationally recognized for the effort that they put into that game.
Bradley then returned for three home games. Jackson was back with a mouth guard and a vengeance, with 23 points against New Orleans. What followed were wins over St. Louis, Western Illinois, and Chicago State in a game that would be the first a Coach Mo team would score over 100 points and featured a spectacular move by senior Mbuku Wagugu.
I just went up to, I was trying to go to dunk it, and they came in front of me, and I was just hoping I'd get it in, you know. But I think that's something that I'm going to remember, yeah, a long time.
Then on to the Cable Car Classic, a tournament that would be the biggest boost for the year. All four teams would make the NCAA. A huge contingent from Peoria filed into the San Jose Arena on a rainy night to watch Bradley's best performance of the season in beating the eventual ACC champs, Georgia Tech.
Now Maddox, who took a bad shot. Parker picks the passing lane. He's down for a kaboom! A steal again for Parker, and it's 45-40. Barry, drop down pass knocked away by Coupette. Saved to Deion Jackson. Deion across the timeline. All the way down. His pull-up drop down pass. Parker, whose layup is up and got it, fouled! Great recognition by Deion Jackson, who found Parker, who now has 21. Now Gaston, a three-point shot is an air ball long, and the ball is tipped by Funches. The other end to Parker. AP going to take the ball all the way down, scoop it up and get it!
With 20 pro scouts on hand, Anthony Parker showed everyone his overall game. And together with Deion's 23, led the red and white into the championship game against the Big Ten's Penn State. Bradley took a lead with just over a minute to go, but Pete Lisicki hit a three, and the team couldn't recover. And the Lions won the tournament. Parker was named to the all-tournament team, as was Deion Jackson, who was the MVP, but he said it didn't matter. The team had failed again to win a championship. They were 6-3, and realistically, they would have just two more chances to win a title. And the preseason league favorites would have a target on their back.
It just seemed like, you know, my senior year, you know, I won a state championship, and now I'm in my senior year again, now in college, and I'm going for a conference championship.
The Missouri Valley Conference season started with a win in Omaha against the Creighton Blue Jays, and Chad Klein was brilliant at a 9-point win at Northern Iowa. Biowa Kinkole, playing with more confidence, led Bradley to a home rematch win over the Blue Jays with 18 before the only home loss of the year. Southwest Missouri State held Bradley to 32% from the field and won by 3 at Carver Arena. They bounced back two nights later against Southern Illinois, and that, of course, meant Dwayne Funchess. They were 4-1 going into Illinois State. A sellout crowd, Redbird Arena, hotly contested and well played. For Bradley, it was Deion Jackson on automatic. He led the Braves with 26. And the contest came down to the final minute with 2 turnovers. And Illinois State capitalized and moved into the Valley League. It was on to Indiana. Kerry Burrell returning to the site of his heroic shot the year before with a career high against Evansville. And the team followed that with a lackluster win over Indiana State in Terre Haute. Back to Carver Arena for easy wins over Wichita State and the Drake Bulldogs. And it set the stage for one of the most memorable games in Bradley history. A Sunday night national TV game against the Tulsa Golden Hurricane, who built an 18-point lead, and the home team seemed hopelessly done. But Dwayne Funchess kept it from being a complete blowout in the first half, and the now-healed Aaron Zobrist and Deion Jackson brought them back in the second. Deion tying the game at 66 on a post move in the lane, and Kerry Burrell stopped Cordell Love to send it into overtime. From there, Anthony Parker put the team on his back and kept Bradley's title hopes alive, winning their 5th in a row. They then hit the road to Springfield, Missouri, and won their first game ever against the Bears, and followed that with a homecoming win over Northern Iowa. Then the trip west, a shocking loss to last place Wichita State, where they lost Chad Klein in the opening minutes with a knee injury and lost the game by 16. They were playing first place tag with Illinois State, with a game at Tulsa on the back half of the trip. It was like game one all over again. Tulsa up 15. Bradley came back to tie it at 66. They needed a stop. And when they got it, AP would take over in OT.
Thompson bring it to the right with 9, now with 8, now with 7. Looks at Fields with 6, now with 5. Drives with 4, all the way down. His layup is missed. Rebound Ruffin in and out of his hands. Walk, not called. Overtime, got the stop. Parker backs up, 14-13 on the shot clock, even at 71. Against Fields, take an inside jump shot, 10-footer, good! 72-73-71.
Anthony waves him out of there, taking 1-on-1.
One final stop, and again, Kerry Burrell was in the middle of it. After a home win over Evansville, it set the stage for the season's final home game. With the teams tied for first place, with 2 to play, it was Senior Day, ESPN, national audience, the largest crowd in Carver history. And for Jim Molinari, it had come down to 5 years of work wrapped into one day. And after the emotion of the day settled, Bradley ran to a 10-point lead, but it quickly evaporated. Down to the last minute again, Parker hit a huge shot as the shot clock ran down and propelled them to a share of the title. The 5 seniors spoke to the crowd knowing they could do no worse than tie for their first championship. And 8 years later at the site that Bradley last clinched a title, the SIU Arena, they would learn at halftime of Indiana State's upset of the Redbirds in Terre Haute. But down in the second half, they showed their character again. Led by Aaron Zobrist and another Saluki onslaught by Dwayne Funchess, they won in overtime to finish 15-3. The marathon was over. After the Southern crowd left, the players cut down the nets. They finally had their championship.
Well, this is 5 years in coming. I mean, everybody talks about this as our dream season, but we've always stressed the process with Coach Mo and everything, and we've worked 5 years for this, and people that say, oh, they've got had one good year, we've had five building years to get to this, and I mean, we're just thrilled to be where we're at, but we're not finished yet.
March Madness in St. Louis, the Missouri Valley Conference Tournament, and earlier, Aaron Zobrist and Dwayne Funchess received special notice for their play during the season. Billy Wright was second team All-Conference. And at the Coach of the Year luncheon, Deion Jackson and Anthony Parker were recognized as first team All-League performers. And for AP, by a wide margin, the Player of the Year.
Well, it's a great honor, but I think it's a tribute to my teammates and how they work with me to get me open, realize my strengths and my weaknesses, and, you know, we work as a team, and fortunately, one of my roles on the team is to create offensively, and, you know, my teammates need me to do that.
Valley Commissioner Doug Elgin presented Ron Ferguson the regular season trophy, and making Marcus Pollard's prophecy complete, Jim Molinari was named Missouri Valley Conference Coach of the Year. The next day, in front of nearly 4,000 Bradley fans at the Kiel Center, the Braves defeated Rudy Washington's Great Bulldogs in Rudy's last game. In the semifinal on Sunday, the opponent was Southwest Missouri State, and the Bears led nearly the entire game. Down a point, needing a stop, they got one. Aaron Zobrist forcing an air ball and a shot clock violation. What happened next would bring the spotlight of the nation on the Bradley Braves.
I knew where I was on the floor at the time. I knew I was running away from the basket, kind of at an angle to pick up the ball. I didn't know if I was past the three-point line or not, but I just grabbed it and just threw it up, just turned and threw it up as hard as I could. And it didn't look too much like a shot, but, you know, it was more of a fling, but it did the job, though.
Parker with it with six, across the line with five, now with four. AP gives it Deion Jackson, in and out of his hands. He shoots at the horn. Goal!